So let's get started. Great to have you, Rovira. Finally, we've been talking for a year, but 2020 sounds like it's 5 years in 1 year. So it sounds like many years we've been talking to each other. And as you probably all know, there was a big announcement, which is very important for both our companies, that Salsify and e-commerce have partnered to offer their services together. And in that instance, I'm very happy to have Rovira. So it will be a bit of a different webinar, because Rovira will have questions for me too. So we are sort of co-hosting and co-asking each other's questions. We, as usual, we will start with Rovira and we'll have a discussion for like 30 minutes, and then you will be able to ask all your questions and we'll answer your question. This session should last between 45 and like an hour, but not more. And as I said, it will be recorded and shared after the fact. So, as you know, Rovira, we start with a fun fact. So we want to know a bit of you, a bit better of who you are. So what's your fun fact?
So my fun fact is, I'm Filipino. My family's from the Philippines. I was born in the Philippines. And recently, Disney had released, I think they're doing this like commemorative Mickey Mouse doll. So they released this short, like one of their Disney shorts, and it was super cool because it was about essentially the Philippines. And to have that shared globally was really interesting to see. It was about like a woman who was a kid back in like the 40s and received a Mickey Mouse doll and then kind of progressed and tried to pass it on to her like granddaughter. And then as kids do, they like kind of wax and wane in interest, but then it all comes together for the holidays. And that was really, really cool because I guess my fun fact is I'm Filipino. I'm very close to my grandmother.
Wow, that not too bad. That's actually bringing emotions to it. So well done. We're feeling warmer, and thanks for sharing that. So now, on a maybe on a less funny tone, but maybe could be funny, you could talk a bit about yourself, who you are, and who is Salsify in a few words.
My name is Ravira Dasik. I have been at Salsify for over 5 years. My first job at the company actually was helping build kind of the earliest integrations to kind of the ecosystem of where our customers. So we work primarily with brand manufacturers, helping them basically get the best version of their content in front of all of their shoppers or partners online. And back when they were still around, so the Jet.com marketplace, if you remember that, that was one of the early integrations that I helped work on. And then I think the company realized that I wasn't actually very good at programming. And so instead, they
That's probably your fun fact too.
that too, yeah. Another home for me at the organization, specifically as a product manager, so on the product team, helping still with this big, big problem that our customers were facing, which is we're investing so much in being able to create and tell our great brand stories, et cetera. But it's just so freaking hard to get that content to our partners, whether it's marketplaces, retailers, their own direct-to-consumer websites. And we want to be able to have an easier, faster, more automated way to share this content with their consumers, with their shoppers. My team really looked at how to build those integrations and make that possible for them. And then over the past 3 or 4 years, my focus had been primarily on the work we were doing with creating this kind of connectivity or ability to send content to your Amazon catalogs.
Okay, and if we dip dive a bit on what, why would you want, or why would you need Salsify, or putting it another way, what are the benefits of Salsify? And one of the purpose of this webinar is to make like the complexity of a big system like Salsify very easy to understand, and the benefits. What would you say the benefits are, the main benefits, in simple terms, for brands?
I mean, in the simplest terms, you know, completely accelerated by the pandemic, but that online is where people are going to literally learn about products, brands, information that they need, whether or not they purchase online or offline, it doesn't matter. And there's been a huge pressure on brands to be able to provide great, accurate content to any digital touch point that needs that information. But you know, the need driven by us as consumers, because like Jerome, how frequently are you buying products online that have bad descriptions or bad images or bad reviews?
Well, none.
Yeah, exactly. So knowing kind of what the stakes were for brands today, they needed like literally to start a platform to help consolidate and centralize all of that information. Because if you can believe it, and maybe the brands on the call can, a lot of that content is living in spreadsheets, other systems, sometimes literally only on Amazon. Like, where's your product info? Oh, it's on Amazon. Where else is it on? No, just Amazon. So like needing to have a place to bring that all together and then easily enrich it, improve it, and push it out to the market, but then have a way to like, you know, tell whether or not that content is working. Is there a way that they can improve it? So we called it almost like this closed loop digital merchandising of constantly being able to iterate and improve the experiences you provide to your customers online, all in like one platform, basically.
Okay, and often the question we hear is that what kind of platforms are you, because you're very good with Amazon, right? You're one of the recognized systems. I think there's only a couple, right? Five or six, which are really officially recognized by Amazon to push content, but you're not only working on Amazon, right? You've got other platforms. Could you give us a bit of an idea of what other platforms you service?
So if you need to get content literally to any digital touch point, whether it's other retailers, other marketplaces, like, you know, Facebook, Instagram, your own brand websites, that is the real beauty of having a system like Salsify in place, because very few customers, if any, are only on Amazon. I think we'll get to this a little bit in the webinar of, you know, what's the value in multi-marketplace listing. And, you know, knowing that's the, that, that's like the, you know, the minimum that we have to hit, like our system is really built for that kind of compounded problem of like, okay, we know Amazon can be difficult. We know that their requirements change all the time. We know that they can be inconsistent between vendor and seller. Now do that and multiply that for every retailer that you support. And that's where then at scale, having a system like this in place can really help.
Yeah. And do you have, could you share the, like other popular marketplaces?
Oh yeah, sure. Yeah. So in the States, and oh, I forgot to mention, I'm based now in Lisbon, Portugal. So about a year ago. Yeah, they, I know, like my mom was just like, oh, the timing. I'm like, I know. So, you know, we've got, I would say, really, really great coverage for, and marketplaces, the that whole kind of framework, I guess, or it's much more common, I would say, in Europe than it is in the US. And in the US, you've got the dominant players like an Amazon, and then now everyone seems to want a marketplace, so like Walmart, Target, et cetera. Those are, call it destinations or places that we help our customers with. And then similarly in Europe, you know, I think depending on whether it's a marketplace or a retailer, you'll always get a varying degree of sophistication on the other side of it. So whether it's they've got the ability to receive content kind of a machine to machine level, or if all they really have for you as a brand is a spreadsheet that you need to fill out, we've developed ways in which we can actually automate that part of it as well. So I guess the answer is like, it doesn't, like the where it needs to go doesn't matter. It's more of, you know, like how it needs to go there. And that's what, where we really, really are strong in.
So yeah, you would support any type of platform. Correct. and give whatever format this platform is asking for. Okay, yeah. That makes it very clear. And How many brands are using Salsify in the US? Do you have like how many today users, let's say, or brands?
Brands, yeah. That? And so you have to remember, we service like thousands of brands, and often though that the customer is going to be like the parent company that comprises a bunch of different brands. I think this is there publicly available. What's the latest number?
Was it a trick
was that question?
A size of how many products are going through your system, like
we've had over millions of products published through our system in the course of our existence. We've got tens of millions of products already in our system that helps power a lot of the analytics that we're working on. But every day, you know, I mean, like, this is one of those things where when you're in this role, you kind of obsess over it. But it's a cool thing that we've got where we can see the publishes go out for any destination, any size of company. It's just like millions of products that are going through.
And if we were to say, like, I'm a brand and I want to understand, does it make sense for me? What do you have criterias of saying, okay, for example, the number of SKUs or number of ASIN, if we're talking Amazon, or the size of your, how much you're selling? Do you have, where would you say it doesn't, like, when does it start to make sense?
Yeah, no, that's a really great question. I'd say that, you know, regardless of where you feel like you're at in terms of, we call it digital maturity, you know, if you're just really starting with getting your content, you know, prioritizing it and making it a core part of your business, most of the brands we work with are really in that, we call it the crawl state, where they're just trying to see, like, bring together all that content. That even to more advanced, that scale will vary across even just size of company. So if you look at, like, maybe the best fit for a Salsify will be a brand manufacturer, because again, we work with retailers in the sense that we partner with them, but we specifically built our platform to meet the needs of a brand owner in Amazon terms. And you know, I'd say that most of them have a few hundred, maybe 1,000 or more to start. So if you're kind of coming in below that, and at the end of the day, it's like, you know, what's the scale problem here? Are you, if you've got five products, do you need automation to really do that? Or is that overkill? But if you feel like, okay, we've got five products today, but we're going to go to 50 to 500, 5,000, and we want the right system in place to support that, then that might be a better fit. But then again, that's dependent on your priorities and where that's.
Okay. So we could say, as a summary, like 1,000 is probably a good fit. But for example, if you have 200 and you're going to five different marketplaces, that's already five times 200. So you're already there. So probably it can start for 150 or 200 in Europe, at least, because very easily we'll go to different markets. So that the first idea. And maybe to summarize the benefits part before we go into sort of examples, is the first benefit I see from what you said is people who've got a disorganized way of having content. Some are on Dropbox, some are on Drive, some are on the computer of him. So that it will help them to organize all their content, to have one area where all the content is. Mm-hmm. The second thing I see is you will save a lot of time, because once you've organized all that content, it's same as putting it on Dropbox or on your Drive or on your system, on your own computer. But here, not only you've organized it, but then you save all the time of uploading with your NIS file or those enormous Excel sheets. So you save a lot of time. So you organize better yourself. You save a lot of time, and from you save also a lot of time by pushing all that content to all the different countries, because, for example, pictures or a lot of things will be the same in every countries, right? So you only have to change the languages, obviously, but. Yeah. Like if your content is same for the UK and in the US, for example, then you only have to press a button for twice and it's done. You've prepared everything. So it's an enormous tool to scale. And from what we've seen, and we've been very excited about that, about the fact of how this empowers you to scale. And it's like having a data content management tool like Salesforce, for example, or any other tool where you start and you it's impressive. Like, okay, you can handle your CRM with 5 customers on your Google Sheet, but if you start to have a 500, it's like, how do you keep all that organized? And this ability to scale for us was very surprising. And maybe we can share some examples. So we've started to work with Sasafa. We have a few, but maybe you've obviously your experience, you're the Sasafi overall expert in Europe and probably worldwide, ladies and gentlemen. But what would be like, do you have any examples of what benefits which were lived by companies?
Absolutely. So there's certainly the just the technology in itself and everything you've kind of described of centralization and getting all that. But, you know, I'll tell you a few stories, because my favorite part about the job is really working with our customers and our partners, just the human aspect of it. And it's really, really exciting to see when even so, Jerome, just working with the e-commerce team, you know, on the project we're working on together, seeing almost turning like disbelievers into believers when they can see like, whoa, you did that for like hundreds of images, or whoa, like we just got like hundreds of products published. I think that's like really cool. Last week, we had a customer in Europe, you know, over, I think just 2 or 3 publishers, you know, submit 10,000 products to their vendor catalog, which they needed to do because they're in a space that requires tight deadlines because of the seasonality of their merchandise. So think about, you know, if you work for a big company or have 10,000 products, how long would that take you today to be able to submit through the NIS templates or the new bulk spreadsheets? Like, yeah.
Prefer not to calculate.
Yeah. And that was just for one marketplace. And now they're going to roll it out to all the European marketplaces. So like, I love that story. We, you know, we got really excited about it internally, because just the think when you're, everyone loves the idea of automation, because of course I'd love to spend more of my time not filling out spreadsheets and instead doing more value added activity, like planning with my vendor manager the assortment, or how much, you know, marketing investment do we need to put in next quarter, then copying and pasting into a spreadsheet. But I think until you can really like see that, and you know, and to be fair, like it's a partnership with any retailer that you work with, they have to be ready to support it as well. I know that, like, you know, the human element of it, like Amazon has been really, really hard at work and seeing that value, because at the end of the day, it's like we all want to be able to get this great content to the consumer. And if you can make it a lot easier for them for brands to do it, then why not, you know, do that? So yeah, some fun stories there. But my favorite though, so anytime you bring brands together to talk about Amazon, it immediately, like, I love it, because it turns almost into like a therapy session where it's like, oh, like, how do you guys fix that thing? Because, like, you know, we didn't get POs that day, or like whatever it might be. And I think just whether it's in the US and seeing similar stories and, you know, cool ways of supporting their own customers or things like that, like, I've seen it applied both in the States as well as in Europe. And I think that just, you know, I read something, Jerome, recently that 70 or 80% of online shopping this year for Germany and France were on Amazon. Like, that to me is wild. And I think it's just gonna continue to grow. So it's I used to joke where if it's like, all right, if you have a handle on Amazon, if you've been tasked by your company to work to really support this business in some ways, think of it as like your own, like, call it job security, call it job opportunity, whatever you might call it. Like, this is the way the world is trending. And I think the fact that we can help our customers be better at this is like the coolest story.
Yeah, and talking of, like, we were looking, we've started using obviously Salsify ourselves, and and we've started on several projects. And I will confess, I was not a big believer of systems, and saying, yeah, I can push your content, and knowing how the Amazon system works, it's like, okay, like a lot of people pretend, okay, they can create a sheet which will work, but it then never really works. And to be honest, it's like, we've started to use Salsify, and I was really impressed myself. It's like, wow. And we have this huge project of content upload of thousands of SKUs worldwide for a big company. And we're in charge of that. And we started to work with Salsify on that. And from the first project, so it's each country goes separate. And the first project, okay, we said, wow, we've probably saved half of our time. Maybe, yeah, 3-4 times. Second country is like, wow, we've saved 4 times time we should have taken. And then step by step, we've saved 10 times the time we would be normally using for that country. So all of a sudden you're saying, wow, the time saving element here is incredible. And it goes on and on. So obviously, for your first country, you need to learn the system. So you need to invest like in any tool. Yeah. Like we everyone is reluctant. The team is like, wow, I need to learn a new tool. But then you know, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and there's a very good onboarding schedule done by Salsify with their experience of onboarding so many brands, of saying, okay, calm down, you know, you need to wait and learn and make sure you understand the system. And then, for example, you have this tool for A+ content, so below the fold, or EBC. It's like, okay, normally you have to do this. And with the tool, it's just oop, 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 3 clicks and it's done. And you can do it for like 100 SKUs all of a sudden and it's done. And you say, wow, is that all? Are we done? And it's true. And for us, that was it's a game changer in terms of efficiency when you have a large catalog, or even for a medium catalog, but going for many countries. And that for us is really breathtaking for me, at least in terms of how it changes our approach to our job, because our job is basically help brands also in their catalog. And a lot of our work is troubleshooting issues with catalogs. And the idea of using a Salsify is that you decrease the number of troubleshooting issues incredibly. Yes. So I think that was a bit from my examples. Let's give an overview before we go in the Q&A session about how this partnership has been sought and why we believe both that this is bringing more value to people, because we're going about it together. So maybe you can start and I'll give you my 5 cents after.
Yeah, no, I think you hit the nail on the head there, where, you know, when we talk about the value of automation and software in your work, it's only one piece to the puzzle, right? Like when automation works well, it's fantastic, because you can rattle off all the other things that if you're honest with yourself and you look at all the tasks that you have to do to really successfully manage an Amazon business, there are so many jobs that have to get done that may not get the quality or attention that you have for it, because you only have a number of hours in a day. So, you know, with a system like a Salsify that can help automate that process, it offloads a lot of time to then, and this is where I think, you know, partnering with experts like Ecommerce is really, you know, now that you've got time to free up to really dig into the strategy component of how you want to do better on Amazon and other, you know, e-commerce channels, you open up the ability to tackle work that really can't be automated. Like, you cannot automate talking to Jerome. You know, you can't, like, that has to be, yeah, you could try. Like, everything that you guys have, all of the knowledge and experience and, you know, your boots on the ground helping brands with this problem every day, we built a solution to help with that. But at the end of the day, you need to marry, you know, the brains and the experience and the skills with the tooling that can help really accelerate the work that you're doing as a brand. And like, that's where, you know, when you think about like how to increasingly, and what I love about our partnership, Jerome, is we both, even from the beginning, we're like, it's not like, okay, just like referring each other to each other, like, eh, that's like fine. Like there's a lot of, you know, great agencies out there. There are a lot of great softwares out there, but like, what's the real value that we can offer to our joint customers? And I think it's that marrying of the two to really help them grow and reach the goals that they've got set out for themselves.
Yeah,
you think?
I think from day one, we were very excited on both sides and seeing what potential value we could bring. And if you look at the value chain of looking at Amazon, you've got, so we go from consulting, helping on strategy when you help bigger accounts. So, okay, how do you do worldwide governance for big groups? How do you do strategy, account strategy? Should I have a vendor, a seller, a hybrid? What do I want to achieve? And then you go into, okay, operations. How do I put people? How do I sell that? And then you've in that operation part, you've got all the tools. It's okay, what tools you know, how much time do I need to devote? How fast do I want to go in every countries? And that's where, as consultants, we're not interested in developing the IT infrastructure because that's not our strong point, and it would not make sense to build them, like the amount of work which has been done by Salsify. So it's saying, okay, you've got a few tools, which, for example, for advertising, that's also, you need some tools to automate, but for content, it's like, it's an enormous piece of content management. And we, from my experience, when we talk to customers, typically the entry point will be an operational problem. As you say, it's like, wow, my negotiation, or like, wow, I'm paying because like I have late deliveries and Amazon is charging me, or there's a pricing issue, or my content is not good and someone from wherever, Japan, has taken over my content, or brand registration is not working. What's that? And it's very often it's an operational issue. It's saying, okay, I'm not understanding what's happening. And most of the time it's saying, okay, we take a step back and say, okay, wait a minute. This operation problem, is it the, you know, the tree which is hiding the forest?
Yeah.
What's the big picture there? What's your vision? What do you want to achieve with Amazon? Because Amazon is a big beast, right? So you want to know how you want to ride the beast and where you want the beast to go, to be honest. So if you have no plan, Amazon will have a plan for you, and that's probably not so good, right? So it's making sure you've having the right plan, and then the execution is like Salsify comes in exactly at that point where it will make you go to the next level, like having the right vision, then having the right content, and then you can add the advertising side and all the like the negotiation and strategic pieces or additionally the other countries. So for us, it comes into a global vision brands should have. It's Amazon is an ecosystem. So if you look at it, if you slice it down, doesn't really work. If you do only content, doesn't really work. If you do only advertising, doesn't really work. If you look at only, oh, I want to get the buy box. Okay, or why, you know, or I want to be a vendor and I don't really care. So you need to have all those parts. And there's with our experience of handling content, we've not seen a better solution than Salsify today. I can't say it differently. We haven't seen a better solution than Salsify to handle medium to larger catalog and expanding internationally. And we believe that with the right strategy and the right tools, this makes an enormous difference in your approach and in your success on Amazon. So we just believe that combining both together, it's giving the best of what can be done to be mm-hmm. successful on Amazon. Mm-hmm. So,
probably. And well said.
Thank you very much. So it's good we agree. And
yeah, starting off on the right foot there. No, definitely. And you know, one other thing to call out with that, Jerome, that as retailers, as these big important marketplaces also continue to invest in technology to make it easier for you to automate, if your tech stack, your tool belt, whether it's technology or your agency partners, consultants, aren't up-leveling their own set of equipment that they're using to support you, then you're immediately falling behind. Because, you know, it's when the retail, like they can make things a lot easier for us or a lot harder for us. And if they're choosing to make it easier for us because of automation, then you want to pair yourself off with the partners that are capitalizing on that automation and providing those tools for you. So I think there's a competitive angle to this as well, where you, given how competitive it is, Amazon is, certainly in the US, for sure growing in Europe, and as they continue to build their presence internationally, making sure you've got that plan, that strategy, but also the right tools in place is what you'll need to keep pushing on.
Yeah, no, I agree. And now is the point where people, you can do, please ask any questions you have pertaining to Salsify or to your strategy on the Amazon, and we'll be happy to answer all of your questions. But to go on what we were talking is, you often talk about the digital shelf, like winning on the digital shelf. And it got me like thinking, okay, digital shelf. Do you mean like it's in a way my background was doing distribution. So when I started working is in Europe, MediaMarkt, for example, was a big retailer, or Fnac in France, or Boots in the UK or others, or Dixon's, and sort of merchandising was a big thing. It's like, okay, how you would look into the shop, you would have a nice booth, was probably a bit of branding, stands, and you would produce standards, everything. So is this approach of digital shelf, is it exactly the same, but on e-commerce, are you basically helping people to better merchandise? Is that what digital shelf stands for?
Yes, and even it's an important nuance here too, which is the reality of shopping today, it is all digital. Even if you're shopping in store, going to your local, so admittedly, new to Portugal, not familiar with the local brands, anything. When I go to El Corte Inglés, I'm on my phone all the time trying to understand not just what it's saying and translating it, but like, what are the reviews of this new product that I've never bought before because I'm new to this country. So the digital shelf, the summary of it is all of shopping is now the digital shelf. And that merchandising example you gave is now being applied digitally.
Mm, yeah, okay. So it's really basically, and I think in Europe and probably in the States, we're a bit late compared to Asia, where they have O2O. It's not B2C, it's O2O. It's offline to online, where everything is integrated. So yeah, it's really making sure that what you have in your shop is also online, and what you have online is also in your shop. So you could get your coffee from the cafe in the area coming to you, delivering, and you could go to a shop to get something you've ordered online. So it's completely integrated, and probably that's the future of commerce in general. It's like, you're not talking B2B.
There's no B anymore. Yeah, it's just big C.
Yeah, exactly. And it's really offline, online. Yeah. And for me is specifically for people who are aware of the situation in France, for example, where there's a lot of people going against Amazon because it's an emblem of e-commerce, and they're saying, okay, Amazon is killing all the small shops, which, I don't, maybe it's a fair comment, but the government's position then, and people are putting pressure to say, okay, we should cancel Black Friday. It's like, we should not have Black Friday in France because it's unfair because the other shops are closed, which, okay, it's true. But it's like the there was a status, the information which went out. It's like in Germany, 70% of the shop are going digital. In France, it's only 30%. So it's how like the brands or the retailers or the people selling the products make sure they're available online. And just pointing out Amazon is probably a bit weak. Just say, okay, the other guys didn't do really their homework to make sure, especially after the first quarantine, to make sure that they have their products also available online for whatever happens. Because will it be the only virus which we will know? Like, who knows? Life will be probably very different in the coming years. So this availability to be having the products available everywhere is so important. And a lot of brands we were talking to before were, okay, not very, Amazon and online was important, but they had so many things, then all their retailers, they were afraid they would make their retailers unhappy. But now I think most of them are understanding the robo effect, research online, purchase offline, where most of the people go online, as you said, in El Corte Inglés or wherever, saying, okay, I'm looking for my products before purchasing, right? So exactly. That, yeah. I was wondering in terms of tips, because you've been working with a lot of brands and mm-hmm. helping them with their content. Do you have any tips for manufacturers, brand manufacturers, about how to approach their catalog and what are the best yeah. practices when they want to go like international or at least pan-European? Yeah. What would be like your main tips?
So, even I think this can apply whether you're focused on just, you know, to start one marketplace and then wanting to go international. But the most successful brands that we work with that feel like they're really, you know, riding the beast in the way that they want to be riding it, they take this test and learn approach. For sure. To the degree that they can do A/B testing, you know, using different platforms to introduce a new product and then bringing those learnings back into their main catalog. I think just having that, the belief that you will never have it be perfect, because the whole game is rigged to always move like the goal line, you know, and we rig it. Consumers are always asking for more or something differently, et cetera. So the tip I would give is be okay with imperfection and know that like the best way to be perfect is always taking this test and learn approach. And I think you can apply that advice also when you want to roll out to new marketplaces, new countries as well. I think for that one, actually, I would tweak it a little bit where you've got that test and learn. Now, more than ever, if you're going to go from, you know, there were five in Europe, I think at the start of the year, and now there's six, will be seven. Yeah. Like at some point you know, it's like you then are at scale, like being able to support each additional marketplace, you need something that can help really improve that process. And it's not just a technology problem, because often, you know, like translations, how are you getting localized relevant search terms or keywords for each different market that you're trying to serve? Like, maybe you can use a translation tool, but maybe like native local speakers that have the expertise and understanding what keywords drive your category for that market could provide that with you. I think so just expanding, you know, there's like again, crawl, walk, run. At a minimum, you need to have something that's going to help you do it at scale, but then also have the ability to localize and build in workflows or processes that allow you to really customize and capture what that local consumer is demanding of your product. And I don't see that yet. Like, I think it's hard to do if you're a smaller to medium sized brand, but if you look at the brands who've got the right toolkit, the right partners, like creating custom experience or just even tailored experiences based on the consumer that they're trying to serve is, I know, I don't know if it's a tip or more just like an aspirational goal that everyone's looking for, but that would be my advice.
Yeah, no, I would relate to that in a sense that often it's the larger the brand you're talking with, the more used they are. If you're talking to people who are in merchandising or doing, like, they have a process and they want it to be perfect, because once it's in the stores, it's like it's done, it's finished. Like, yeah. And but on Amazon, it's the other way around. It's like so oftentimes you say, okay, what's the best strategy for our advertising? Is okay, like normally, typically you would say, okay, we need to try the all for conversion rate for content. It's like, okay, let's try this content and we'll see on real data. Or sometimes they brands, I have a fun story also from a German brand I was working with, and they had a product, it was binoculars, and there was a size 10 by 50, which is a big binocular. And I was selling for a long time, we sold binoculars, and we knew that this size didn't sell in Europe, like end of story, they didn't sell. This size was sold in the US because people were used to buy that. And it was a story. So we knew that we wouldn't sell that. And we started sell on Amazon. What happened is the number one sale was obviously the 10 by 50. Why? It's because a lot of products, when you go through normal retailers, the buyer or the seller inside the retailer, he will say, yeah, nobody buys it. So he's sort of conveying a message and saying to the potential end consumers, yeah, nobody buys it, so don't buy it, buy another one. Yeah. But on Amazon, nobody knows it. So it's like it happens. If you don't try it, you will never know if it's working or not. And a lot of brands will say, you know, we know it doesn't sell. And come with this example saying, okay, I was 100% convinced because I would have been selling binoculars for 10 years. And I said, no, it doesn't work. And what happened is we were selling thousands and thousands because customers saw, oh, it's a great product. There's nobody else selling it. Okay, yeah. I'll take it. And yeah. I had, again, today, another was a big oral care brand and saying, okay, this product, now we know it won't sell. You know, customers won't like it. And I said, okay, why don't you try? And let's check on real data. And one example is what happened with launching in Sweden. You can see Amazon does exactly the same. They launched in Sweden with a lot of mistakes. They had a lot of swear words in their content. They had the wrong flag for Sweden. It was showing, I think, the Mexican flag or something. So it's like incredible mistakes for such a big company. But I think in Amazon's view is, okay, we need to move.
Yeah.
And if we make mistakes, we'll repair. And people say, oh, it's a disgrace. And okay, like in 1 year, everybody will have forgotten and they will probably sell a lot of products. So it's like this approach of testing out and looking at data is very important. And we typically would recommend really to test things and not try to make perfect. Yeah. It's practice makes perfect. So, and trial and error, like you were saying, and A-B testing. Yeah. And talking about A-B testing, do you, because now Amazon is you have some options that sometimes on A+ content, you can do A-B testing. On brand stores, they were talking about A-B testing. Do you have this functionality of A-B testing inside?
So we have customers who, even before Amazon was providing that as an option, were already doing it through, you know, often through manual means, but it was part of their, they knew that they needed to adopt this test and learn methodology in order to really stay ahead of the competition. Because sales velocity matters most with Amazon. And so they realized that that's something they needed to protect. So I know with what Amazon is working on and similar to what they're doing with being able to provide an easier way to get content to their vendor catalogs, for example, a lot of that automation will eventually become more available for customer or companies like a Salsify and others. But yeah, with our solution, you know, people were already A-B testing before it was available, and the automation aspect of it will just continue to improve.
And do you have, is Salsify helping you to give you insights on which A or B is working best? Like is the system helping brands taking the right decision?
We could probably be doing, just from if I put my product hat on, a much better a job doing that, of making it more explicit and clear. We've got we have a fantastic product page report, which can actually show you, you know, like, are you meeting kind of a threshold, whether it's for your category that we surmise based on our own number crunching, or even if you have your own like custom rubric that you measure yourself against, we can provide that as well. You know, there are, like taking the Amazon philosophy, a lot of ways in which we can improve as a product, but just to answer your question, we can provide you with a sense of like, oh, has your performance improved because of the new content that you pushed out?
Okay, and it leads to a question I had earlier about KPIs. I know and large brands specifically, which are not so familiar with Amazon and typically would in their normal retail would look at KPIs of, like, when you were doing merchandising in the old days, you would know exactly where you were selling and where you were, which space of the physical shelf.
Yeah.
And they are very, a lot of brand are, which are very marketing driven, are very KPI driven, which is, you know, makes sense. How is Salsify helping to those KPIs? Like you've got tools like Helium 10, for example, you can have it on your on Google Chrome, for example, and it will give a rating about the content. So it gives you an idea of how good of a job you're doing. But do you have something which is a bit more consistent
So, and actually this will be good to get your take on too. Like what do you think are the core set of KPIs anyone selling on Amazon should be tracking, because there are a lot of, you know, the same things that you would care about, but you have to differentiate. So search ranking as well as, you know, frequency of buy box ownership, your own internal sales data is one for sure. Your ability to, you know, how frequently are you pushing updates to Amazon? How much product assortment has grown since using automation? The speed, we talked earlier, the importance of being able to do things much more quickly. How much time savings have you earned because of your because of the automation that you have in place? A lot of those are like the reporting mechanisms that, you know, a user of the platform would absolutely want to show their executive sponsor or their boss who's paying for the solution. I sort of see it as a difference between like the KPIs within the platform, but then also what's your take, Jerome, on like what anyone selling on Amazon should really be prioritizing from a
KPI perspective? The one which is most important for me is conversion rates, because conversion rate is giving you end of the day if you're doing well. So you would start with like conversion rate and sales, and then probably ACOS, so advertising figures, and how much you're selling organically and how much you've got paid paid sales, so to speak, with through advertising or promotion. And then you've got the other ones, like you said, lost by box, and out of stock rates, which are for me, if already those five, you can usually have a good idea of if you're doing a good job or not a good job. And more than those numbers on their own, it's how they're progressing or not progressing in one way or the other. But it's like specifically,
glance views kind of live in when you think about what brands should be thinking about. Because I know it was always a number that was a little bit hard to derive, because Amazon never really, at least on the vendor side, provided loss, basically sales opportunity based on how many people left or how many consumers landed on your page versus bought. Where does that live within your ranking?
So, that's another way of looking at conversion rate, but you're right. It's like conversion rate is how many of those glance views have turned into sales. And you're right, on the vendor side, like brand analytics now is only giving you a trend, like if your conversion rate has gone up or down. And the only real data you get of conversion rates on the vendor side is through the advertising. Like you will know how much your advertising is converting, which is a different way of looking at it. On the seller side, you've got more information because you've got all the glance views. So you can know exactly what's your conversion rate. So that's how we look at it. But it's true, on the vendor side, we have less information. So we have to look more at the other parts. And on the vendor side, like lost buy box has a very big impact, obviously, because it means Amazon will, although on the vendor side, the system will ask you to lower your costs to Amazon. So that's where
crapping out if you don't lower, because you can't, because you've lost margins on it, and then what do you do because of that?
And that goes in our flywheel of our e-commerce growth model, is, and then you go back to the strategy and say, okay, do I have the right distribution in place and pricing strategy in place? Because obviously you can't say to Amazon to which price they need to sell, so that makes it a bit complicated. But going back into KPI, because I know a lot of bigger companies were arguing about, if we're talking specifically of the ROPO effect and the fact of a brand saying, because a lot of big brands are saying, okay, it's okay if I'm not selling on Amazon. It's like, I need to be there because I'm a big brand and I want my brand to look really good. So on the content side, it's like, what kind of KPI would Salsify help them to understand? Because then you say, okay, I'm implementing this tool, Salsify, to help me, you know, grow, have a great content quickly, efficiently, and everywhere. What kind of thing could what kind of KPIs would you be able to follow, and what would you suggest?
I can share a bit of what just based on the experiences of our customers and what they come to us with in terms of their goals. Exactly that, you know, for a lot of, we talk about Amazon strategy, maybe that strategy is not to make a lot of money off of it, but to have a really great brand story across all of your ASINs, right? Or a good, talk about Pareto efficiency, like a good 80% of your ASINs that are doing the most for your business. Because you know that it doesn't matter if they convert on Amazon, so long as they can find that information, then they may convert elsewhere. So I think when you look at it from a, that's one, is like, can we get like better quality content that they assume is better? And usually they're investing in the help of partners for creating the content or whatever it might be. And then can we apply this across all of, you know, our shelf, basically all the different digital touch points that a consumer may be looking or researching that product. I think that's a big one. And they usually measure it off of, you know, how many, we call them channels have published, you know, how many channels are we live on? How much of our assortment in Salsify has been pushed out to all of those channels, using the product page reports that we've got, you know, are we at an A level or a B level for all of those different endpoints? So that is, I would say, like breadth of coverage, quality of content, and quality of volume of assortment and coverage as well. Yeah.
And I know the system also is able to tell you when you're losing content, basically when someone has taken over some of your content, or the system has got a glitch. Basically, Salsify is able to proactively come to you saying, okay, careful, your content has been lost.
Yeah. That's, I think Amazon especially, probably one of the top frustrations for anyone selling, for any brand selling, brand owner, brand registered owners. You invest all this money creating, you know, great quality content, but because of prior distribution agreements in which you've got third-party sellers now, you see, with sales velocity on that content, and their content continues to show up, like, how do you prove ROI on that investment for creating great quality content if you can't even have it show up on the page? To your point, the brand compliance report is hugely important for our customers to see, to have something proof to Amazon that they can take and say, hey, like, we just sent all this information over. You still haven't used it yet. We're brand registered. You know, that is actually factually wrong, that what's on the page today, and is proving a poor customer experience. Like, let's work together to get this fixed. So I think, to your point, having that visibility though, en masse in bulk is really helpful for these brands to be able to fight that fight.
Yeah. That's for sure. Like, I can testify. And this will probably be the final question. So if you have any last minute question, do throw them in the Q&A section. Is in your experience, because Amazon is not, it's like, it's volatile a bit. It's not very stable as a system. It moves. It has some glitches and so on. It's so big.
Because they're always testing and learning, right? Like, and that's
exactly. So it's not always very stable, and they have a lot of different systems which have to replicate and so on. Mm-hmm. So in your experience, will the content which is pushed through Salsify have more chance to stick, let's say, or to be really pushed online than mm-hmm. doing it manually? That's the first thing. And the mm-hmm. second thing is, sometimes Amazon is being very difficult in terms of suspending items or like saying, okay, your product is not allowed. Or do you have an experience, like, does having Salsify help on that front, or is difficult to say?
No, it's easy to say. That first question is there is no external solution out there that can that can enforce Amazon to do anything with what they own, which is their own product detail pages. It's their real estate, and it makes sense to me. Like they reserve the right to be able to show whatever they want on there. However, having said that, as we've seen in the news, et cetera, that Amazon is very much aligned with creating really quality shopping experiences. Like brand and Amazon want the same thing. And I really do believe that brands have excellent content. We've seen it firsthand. We help our customers with this every day, that they want Amazon to consider putting on those live pages. So I think in that vein, if there's any provider that tells you that we can guarantee Amazon's going to use the content through our system, they're lying to you, because that's not possible. But two, there are, you know, work with a partner that understands the challenge and is trying to improve it, because at the end of the day, everyone's really aligned on wanting to create great shopping experiences. Sometimes we have to like remove our own blockers, and sometimes it's ourselves, in order to help support that. So that's one. And then I think the second question, like, yeah, if you're trying to submit content that's like just against Amazon's policies.
No, I was more talking about products which sometimes they say on like health products in the last months because of COVID, of this category was very unstable. Right. Yeah. It's like, do you have experience of using SalesFire tool, making it easier than when you're doing it manually?
Yeah, I mean, so if you were, we definitely experienced this with our February, March, when that all happened. And I think this is a good parting note, is, you know, if you are primarily selling first party to Amazon as a vendor, and they cut off your flow of orders because you're not in that category that they can't literally prioritize, what a lot of them have been really trying to do, and they've been trying to do this for years now, but now I think have the business case to support it, is considering a direct-to-consumer line of business, or selling directly on the marketplace as a seller.
Yeah, drop shipment or
yeah, that. Yeah, exactly. And we can support that as well. So, yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Rovira. We spot on 1 hour, right. Like let's say 56 minutes with the 4 minutes waiting. But that, so this is the end of this session. It was really great to have you. We're very excited, as hopefully you've seen, about what SalesFire is bringing, and what we could be bringing, and what we are bringing today to customers as a team. Yeah. And we'll hopefully have another session sometime soon to go on and share other great successes with SalesFire and e-commerce.
Oh, I'm sure of it. And from our side of it, we are so excited for this partnership and really continuing to add joint value to our customers. So thank you, Jerome, for today.
Thank you, Rovira. Thank you, everyone. Have a great evening or day if you're in the States.
Yeah.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.